Well, good morning, church. I greet you in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It's once again good to meet with you this morning on this wonderful Lord's Day. We continue to give thanks to the Lord for his provision, for his sustenance, especially through these trying times. Just another reminder that we have protocols in place to observe to ensure the safe, to ensure that we meet safe, and those protocols include wearing a face mask throughout the course of the service and ensuring that you've sanitized your hands at the two entrances. Please do make sure you do that. We also try and ask that as far as possible that you refrain from using the toilets so that we make use of as less space in this building as possible to also help and mitigate against any concerning matters when it comes to this this virus. And then there are, just at the end of the service, we encourage you to reflect on the message and spend some few minutes thinking through what God has spoken. And if you are done with that and you are going to engage in conversation with someone, we encourage you to take that conversation outside, just where there's more ventilation, air, and also more space. And so thank you for your cooperation thus far. We've had 3 months, almost 4 months of some wonderful times together in person again, and we've managed to do all things as we ought to. And so let's continue to comply so that we can have these safe services. And so we thank the Lord also for making this possible. Well, let's turn our hearts towards worship and towards worshiping our great God and Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And to guide our hearts this morning to worship him, I draw your attention to God's word, to Psalm 32 as our call to worship. Psalm 32 as our call to worship. And we'll read from verse 1, Psalm 32. May the Lord speak to you through his word this morning and draw your hearts to worship Christ through our time together this morning. Psalm 32, verse 1. Hear the word of the Lord. Blessed is the one whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man against whom the Lord counts no iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. When I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me, my strength was dried up as by the heat of summer. I acknowledged my sin to you, and I did not cover my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. Therefore, let everyone who is godly offer prayer to you at a time when you may be found. Surely in the rush of great waters they shall not reach him. You are a hiding place for me. You preserve me from trouble. You surround me with shouts of deliverance. I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you with my eye upon you. Be not like a horse or a mule without understanding, which must be curbed with bit and bridle, or it will not stay near you. Many are the sorrows of the wicked, but steadfast love surrounds the one who trusts in the Lord. Be glad in the Lord and rejoice, O righteous, and shout for joy, all you upright in heart. That's the word of the Lord for us this morning. Be glad, rejoice, and shout for joy, all you upright in heart. Let's pray. Oh God, we thank you this morning for this time that we have once again to gather together as your church, as your people, oh Lord, as those whom you've called out of this world, oh God, and made your very own special possession. We thank you, oh God, for your continued sustenance and provision. We thank you for the support that you give us, not only for life, but also for our faith, oh God. And so this morning, once again, our hearts are grateful to you. We come and we join together to sing your praises, O Lord, to give thanks for your many mercies and many blessings, O God. And so I pray that you'd meet with us this morning. I pray that you would strengthen us, O God. I pray, O God, that you would encourage us, dear Lord. I pray that you'd bless both our corporate singing, O God, the public reading of Scripture, and then would you bless the preaching of your word as we wait on you this morning, as we seek you this morning. Oh Lord, fix our gaze upon you. Help us to avoid distraction. And may we be focused solely this morning on worshiping our great God and Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And so bless our time as we ask you these mercies. In his name, amen. Praise the Lord. Would you stand with me as we sing our first hymn, Guide Me, O Great Jehovah. I did wish you all a warm welcome to our service already, but a special warm welcome to the Nell family who's with us this morning. It's good to have you with us, and we trust that you will have a blessed service. They are here in Cape Town, hoping to stay here in Cape Town, I believe. And so we do trust that your stay will be warm and welcoming. Thank you for joining us this morning. I love that line in the hymn that we just sung about crossing the Jordan. It prepares us and it sets us up for our scripture reading this morning, our Lord's Day public reading of scripture this morning. We are encouraged in God's word to give attention to the public reading of scripture. That is to say that there ought to be in the service the reading of God's word, where God's people hears his word, and later on we do give attention to the preaching of scripture. But for now, I just want God's word to be read out and your hearts and your ears to hear God's word and to receive nourishment. Remember, Jesus said, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. And so we have a wonderful opportunity this morning to hear the reading of God's word and to take in God's word and to be nourished by God's word, because we don't only live on bread, but on every word of God. And so we've got two readings this morning, a reading from the Old Testament and a reading from the New Testament. Our Old Testament reading this morning is taken from the book of Deuteronomy. So if you're in the Old Testament, that will be the fifth book from the beginning, Genesis, Exodus, and you have Leviticus, Numbers, and then you've got Deuteronomy. So it will be the fifth book in the Old Testament, Deuteronomy. And it's just before the book of Joshua. And so in case you're trying to just navigate your way there, usually we have the Pew Bibles, and then we just give the page number, but we are trying to limit the handing out of things that would otherwise cause a problem. So Deuteronomy chapter 28, and the context here is God's people are preparing to cross the Jordan, quite literally. God is leading his people into the promised land, into the land flowing with milk and honey. And as part of their preparation, there is given for them instructions. And some of the instructions include blessings if they are obedient. And so this chapter is where God is speaking to his people and is assuring them of the blessings that are theirs if they are obedient to him. And so let's read Deuteronomy chapter 28 from verse 1, and we'll read till verse 14. And if you faithfully obey the voice of the Lord your God, being careful to do all his commandments that I command you today, the Lord your God will set you high above all the nations of the earth, and all these blessings shall come upon you and overtake you. If you obey the voice of the Lord your God, blessed shall you be in the city, and blessed shall you be in the field. Blessed shall be the fruit of your womb, and the fruit of your ground, and the fruit of your cattle, the increase of your herds, and the young of your flocks. Blessed shall you be, blessed shall be your basket and your kneading bowl. Blessed shall you be when you come in, and blessed shall you be when you go out. The Lord will cause your enemies who rise against you to be defeated before you. They shall come out against you one way and flee before you seven ways. The Lord will command the blessing on you and on your barns and in all that you undertake. And he will bless you in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. The Lord will establish you as a people holy to himself, as he has sworn to you, if you keep the commandments of the Lord your God and walk in his ways. And all the peoples of the earth shall see that you are called by the name of the Lord, and they shall be afraid of you. And the Lord will make you abound in prosperity, in the fruit of your womb, and in the fruit of your livestock, and in the fruit of your ground, within the land that the Lord swore to your fathers to give you. The Lord will open to you his good treasure, the heavens, to give the rain to your land in its season, and to bless all the works of your hands. And he shall lend to the and you shall lend to many nations, but you shall not borrow. And the Lord will make you the head and not the tail, and you shall only go up and not down if you obey the commandments of the Lord your God, which I command you today, being careful to do them. And if you do not turn aside from any of the words that I command you today, to the right hand or to the left, to go after other gods, to serve them. There we've got some real wonderful and rich instructions for those who are called to obedience, that there is indeed blessing. God is not unaware of our faithfulness and our obedience, but he blesses that richly. Our New Testament reading this morning is taken out of 1 Peter, 1 Peter chapter 2. And so in your Bibles, you can turn with me to 1 Peter chapter 2. 1 Peter chapter 2, that will just follow the book of James. And of course, 1 Peter is right before 2 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 2, and we'll read from verse 1 through to verse 10. Again, we see this idea of the gathered and the collective people of God, not only in the Old Testament, but also here in the New Testament. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 1. So put away all malice and all deceit and hypocrisy and envy and all slander. Like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk, that by it you may grow up into salvation, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. As you come to him, a living stone, rejected by men, but in the sight of God chosen and precious, you yourselves, like living stones, are being built up as a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For it stands in Scripture, behold, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone, chosen and precious, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. So the honor is for you who believe, but for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone, and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. They stumble because they disobey the word, as they were destined to do. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. May the Lord bless the reading of his word. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you this morning for the scriptures. We thank you this morning for the bread of life. We thank you this morning for your very word, O God. We thank you for opening our eyes and opening our hearts and enabling us, O God, to not only hear, but also to receive and to heed your word. O God, we are mindful, though, that there are times when we are under temptation and we succumb, O God. We are mindful, O God, that there are times when we do sin against you and we are not as obedient as your word instructs us, O God. This is not only a few of us, O Lord, but this accounts for all of us. If there's any who says he's without sin, he lies and the truth is not in him, your word teaches us. And so we are all, O God, sinners. We are all prone to wander. We are all prone to leave the God that we love. And we all do give in to temptation, O God, from time to time. But we do pray this morning, as we come to you, we acknowledge our sin before you. Lord, as we are seated here, we are mindful of our own failings, of our own shortcomings, of our own sins, Lord. And it's before you that we come this morning to seek forgiveness. And so we confess our sins, and we ask that you would forgive us our iniquity. We pray, O Lord, that you would cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And we ask, O God, that for your name's sake, you would lead us in paths of righteousness. O God, we thank you for Jesus Christ, our Savior, who took upon himself our debt, Lord. The debt that we could not pay, O Lord. Jesus Christ paid in our stead when he died upon a cross and when he was judged for us, so that all those who believe in him can have all their sins forgiven. And this is the good news. This is the gospel. This is, O God, our hope, that in him there is forgiveness of sins. And so we thank you this morning that though we are sinners and that though we do sin, we can receive in Jesus forgiveness for our sins, cleansing from our unrighteousness, and through the Holy Spirit, empowerment to live a life pleasing to you. And so we give our hearts and ourselves over to you this morning. Take my life, O God. Take our lives, O Lord, and let it be pleasing unto you. Thank you for Jesus, our Savior. Thank you for your Holy Spirit who indwells us. Continue your work of sanctification. Continue your work of conforming us so that we will be more like Christ, our Savior. We thank you, O God. When Satan tempts us to despair and tells us of the guilt within, help us, O God, to look upward to Christ, our advocate, our Savior, our righteousness, our Redeemer. And so I pray, O God, that you would bless your people. These mercies we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand with me again as we sing our next hymn, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing.
Come thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount, I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise my Ebenezer, here by thy great help I've come, and I hope by thy good pleasure, safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger, interposed his precious blood. Thank you. day when, freed from sinning, I shall see thy lovely face. Clothed then in blood-washed linen, how I'll sing thy sovereign grace. Come, my Lord, no longer tarry, take my ransomed soul away. Send thine angels now to carry me to realms of endless day. Oh, to grace, how great a debtor daily I am constrained to be. Let thy goodness, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above.
Praise the Lord. You may be seated. Well, as we prepare our hearts to hear from the Lord through the preaching of His Word, it's my great privilege to introduce our speaker this morning. This morning we have the privilege of having Shane Philander with us. Shane serves as the youth pastor at St. Matthew's in Tableview. St. Matthew's is part of the Reformed Evangelical Anglican Church of South Africa, the REACH denomination, and he's been serving there for quite a few years as the youth pastor and filling the pulpit on many occasions. Shane is here with his wife, and I think it's only appropriate that we wish them and congratulate them. They've recently announced that they are pregnant and expecting, and so his wife, I believe, is 3 months, and she is sitting in my office watching the service being streamed, as there's a facility that she needs more than a bit more often as some of us. And so his wife Alex is here. Shane went far and wide to look for a wife. He's found a wife in Ukraine, and so he's brought her all the way to South Africa, and they got married last year in Ukraine, I believe, and I was able to attend the wedding virtually. They recorded me and sent my voice through to wish them at the ceremony. And so we welcome Shane and Alex as they visit with us. And Shane this morning will open up God's word for us. So Shane, would you come and open up the scriptures?
Good morning. Thank you, Michael. I don't want Rian to infect me, so that's supposed to be funny. I assume you're laughing. Good morning, everyone. It's great to be with you all, as Rian said. I'm originally from Paul, so it's Eindelijk Afrikaans, Eerste Taal. And I see people going, yeah, Afrikaans people in the house. So, but I speak English for your sake. But I'm from Paul, grew up in Paul, met Rian in 2005, became friends, and have been friends ever since. And he's and his wife Grace, they are good friends to us, a great blessing in so many ways that I can't explain. I see his mom in the back, so he can testify to our friendship. But let me read for us from Ephesians chapter 3, if you can turn with me to Ephesians chapter 3. And we will read from verse 14 to verse 21. Only that little section there. Chapter 3, verse 14 to verse 21.
For this reason, I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with all the Lord's holy people, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus through all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Father, we turn to you with your word. And so it's just natural and right to expect that you preach by your Holy Spirit through your word. You understand your word the best because you wrote it. You inspired your apostles to write it. And so we know that if anyone can explain and do proper exposition and work in hearts and affect the souls of each and every individual, yeah, Lord, that is you. Father, we come from different backgrounds with different life circumstances, and so one would think and know that the application will fall in the right place, O Lord, for each and every person, that you will expose their own sin and need of you, O Lord, to themselves. For we are often most blind, not to others, for we are easy to see the sin in others, Lord, but we are often most blind to the sin and the iniquities in our own hearts. We are often discouraged when we ought to be encouraged, O God, because we tend to be negative, O Lord, all the time when the word is there to lift us up. And so if somebody needs encouragement, may you open their eyes. If somebody needs comfort, may you comfort their hearts, O Lord, whether it's they are struggling with ill health, whether, O Lord, they are struggling with finances, whether they have struggles in family life, in their marriages, may you bring the consolation that only you can bring. And may no one leave here the same, knowingly or unknowingly, but may we all know that God has spoken, the Spirit is working, and Christ is glorified. Not because we deserve it, but in Jesus' name, and the church together says, Amen. Well, my wife and I recently watched the BBC version of the great novel by Leo Tolstoy called War and Peace. Now, this novel is known as the greatest novel ever written, arguably so. But in the final scene of this, the movie version of this great book, the two main characters, Pierre and Natasha, after years of being ignorant of their love for one another, they come together by providence. And as Pierre approaches Natasha to make his heart and his emotions and his feelings known to her, and he looks into her eyes as he ought to, he asks her this question. He says, "Can you love me?" He doesn't say, "I love you." He proposes and he says, "Can you love me?" Almost to say that to not be loved is possible. Not only because of who he was, but also because of who she was. Because it is possible to not be loved. Now, given what her preference was in a man, if she was a fickle person, if she was superficial in her selection, it will expose her heart that it is possible to not love someone. And on the other hand, it is possible to not love someone because of who he was, because the people are fallen and they are sinners, and there's enough to not love in people. Can you love me? It's not difficult to see why that is a real question, even in the times that we are living in our country, that the one thing that is lacking in our country today, wherever you watch the news, is that there's a lack of love. It's possible to not love someone else, and it's possible not to love someone else because of my own heart. Can you love me? He asked. And today we see Paul's thinking about love, not necessarily romantic love, but a love more profound, that is the love of Christ. And so we're going to look at three things. We're going to look at the source of love, we're going to look at the sensibility of love, and we're going to look at the scope of love. The source, the sensibility, and the scope. And this love is part of Paul's thinking about what he said already in chapter 3. He talks in chapter 3 about God's mystery being revealed in Christ, that the Gentiles are now part of the church, equal with the Jews, and therefore they ought to be loved and they ought to love back. That's why look at verse 14 in your Bibles. It says, for this reason. Now, if you don't know the reason why a scripture also always says therefore or for this reason, it means it says whatever went before for that reason. Let me tell you about the love. He says, I bow my knees before the Father for this love. But look at verse 16 to 17 first. Paul prays for God's power to strengthen the inner being of the Ephesian church. Obviously, the individuals is praying that I pray for power that you will be strengthened in your inner being so that Christ may dwell in your hearts. Why? Why must Christ, by God's power, dwell in their hearts? The answer is so that they can love. So Paul moves on to the gift of love, saying that God's power moves the believer who are in Christ, he moves them to love. Look in your Bibles with me. Three times in the NIV. Now if he uses the ESV, it will only come up twice, but three times in the NIV, Paul uses the word love. Look at verse 17. So that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray, and I pray that you, being rooted and established in love. The believer is rooted and established in love. Look at verse 18. This is the part in the ESV where it doesn't come up, but in the NIV it does. In verse 18, it then says that you may have power together with all the Lord's holy people to grasp how high, wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ. The believer knows that this love goes, or the believer understands, comprehends, and grasps the love of Christ. Then in verse 19, it says, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be full to the measure of the fullness of God. So the believer knows that this love goes beyond human reason and human intellect, is a love that we cannot really define. That's why we find it so difficult to say, what is love? In other words, the believer's ability, tendency, and commitment to love comes from God's power in Christ. Yes, there is a general inbuilt care for fellow humans that God placed within us, as there should be. All people are made in the image of God, and their human dignity needs to be recognized and respected as part of God's creation. However, church, biblical and Christian love, moved by power, is a far more richer, deeper reality and action than merely recognizing someone else's humaneness. Love moved by power is a kind of love that moves us beyond being nice, being superficial, and just merely having good manners. Being nice and being good manners is not love. It's being nice and having good manners. We often greet people we don't like, because it's good manners. It's not love. For Paul, the love of Christ in biblical and Christian and obedient love is the kind of love that makes the Jew loves the Gentile. Something that would have been impossible in the natural capacity of Paul. Paul says earlier in verses 7 to 8, you don't have to turn there, I will just read it for you. He says, I became a servant of this gospel by the gift of God's grace given me through the working of his power. Although I am less than the least of all the Lord's people, this grace was given me to preach to the Gentiles the boundless riches of Christ. The power of God was so at work within his ministry and within him that it moved him from Jewish tradition to Gentile, being sympathetic to them and love, that he went all the way and preached to a Gentile, which at the time you would not even dare to enter their home. That's love. That's love moved by power. But here's the dilemma. The reason we, you and I, struggle to love is because we lack the power of God to love. Not lacking as if God's power is not available for us to love others, because the day you got saved and I got saved, God's power became yours and it became accessible to you in Jesus Christ to be able to love. But we struggle, and many believers struggle, and lack love because they depend on the artificial means of love and not on God's power. What do I mean by that? Many people fool themselves and therefore pride themselves that they do not need God's power to love because they have naturally loving personalities. There's no such thing as somebody just having a loving personality. There used to be a pop singer, and you all will know. If you don't know, you can go find out. But he used to come on the stage and descend like this demigod, and the crowds will be in front of him, and they will faint all around him. And for 5 minutes, he will stand dead still. And he will say periodically, I love you. I love you. I love you. And a few years later, they accused him of child molestation. There's no one who's naturally loving by their personalities. Our personalities are too wicked, too fallen, too poisoned that we are naturally loving. No, it's the power of God in Christ Jesus when we can become believers that activates with us by the Holy Spirit to be loving. Not that we do it in a strength of our own, but when it feels difficult, we overcome that hurdle of not being loving. In fact, C.S. Lewis says, even your niceness, God gave to you. The point is, the real Christian love comes from God's power, not ourselves. Our favorite thing, church, is to hate, to despise, to slander, to criticize. That is our default setting, even as believers. You will see it in people who once used to be very in love, and then their marriage didn't work out. For whatever reason, they got a divorce. At one moment, they say, I love you, through sickness and in health, to riches and poverty, and when it all went wrong, they say, I can't stand that person. Because it's in us to click it like a switch when we want to. So there's no one who loves merely by their so-called personality. Now, Paul tells us that biblical and Christian and obedient love is grasping that it's only in the person of Christ alone that one can love others truly. Turn back to your Bibles. Notice in verse 17, Paul says that, the first point, Christ is the source of love. He says the result of Christ dwelling by power is love. Let's look how this is the result. Verse 17, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, and I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, or rooted and grounded in love. When Christ is in you, what becomes your root like a tree is love. So what you produce as fruit is lovingness, kindness, gentleness, compassion, because love is your wellspring in Christ. He's the source of love. This means that it is impossible to have Christ dwell in us. That is to call ourselves Christians, believers, or spirit-filled, or regenerated, and not being loving. It's impossible. The two cannot go together. You cannot be in Christ and be a hateful, bitter person. Christ in you by power is the reason for love flowing out of you. Love is the root and the foundation of Christ's presence in you. And by Christ's presence, Paul means being Christ-like, imitating his example to love by loving God, loving the poor, loving your neighbor, and even, as the Bible says, loving your enemies. Matthew chapter 22, verse 37 says it this way: love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind. Your whole person becomes committed to love when Christ, by God's power, dwells in your heart. 1 John 4:11-12, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. The way God is seen in us, church, is if we love. And the way people experience the completeness of God's love in us is if we love. God becomes real in us in the person of Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit if we love. The way people see God in us when we have Christ in us is if we love. There's no other way. Love, love, love. John also says in 1 John 3:16, this is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us. That's how we know by definition what love is, that Jesus died for you and me, undeserving sinners. When we found him repulsive, he died. Look at verse 18. Now, as I said earlier, if you got the ESV, it doesn't come up again, but if you do have the NIV, it does. Paul makes his second point. He now shows us the sensibility of love. So remember the first point, the source of love is Jesus Christ. The sensibility of love. He says that God's power does not only make you possess love in the likeness of Christ, but Paul says God's power also helps you to understand God's love in the likeness of Christ. You don't only possess it, you understand the thing that you are possessing. Look at verse 18. That you may have power together with all the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ. Meaning, what was once incomprehensible and unthinkable is now clear. That in Christ alone, the hateful heart can now love. Paul at one point only felt hatred towards the Gentile in his Jewish practice and as he persecuted them. But as a believer in Christ and part of the church, he now loves them. And he prays the same thing for the church, that this will be the reality of their hearts as well. And not only love them, but understand why they love them. In other words, to love as Christ loved is only the first step of God's power at work in you. The second is God's power in you will also make you understand why you are loving. Nobody understands why you love the person that you used to not like. But you get it. It is Christ in me that has moved me to now love somebody I could never stand. The world doesn't get it. They say, how could you forgive them after everything is done to you? How do you even get this right? You say, I couldn't get it right. If Christ did not come and change my heart by the Holy Spirit, I will be a hateful person. But it's Jesus in me that makes me love. Notice Paul's answer in the rest of verse 18. To grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ. Meaning, power makes the believer grasp the encompassing love of Christ. So you understand your love for others, not because you're so loving. Neither do you understand your love for others, also because not because they're so lovable, but you understand your love for others because Jesus Christ came to die for sinners. His love is wide, his love is long, his love is high, his love is deep. High that he came from heaven to earth. Wide because it is eternal. Deep because he went down into the grave. That's the love of Jesus. This morning when you woke up, you were swept in a fountain, in an ocean of grace. You could not go too far where his love could not cover you because it's so wide. You could not feel too depressed where his love could not lift you up because it's so deep. You could not go anywhere where love for you were not sufficient. Oh, how he loves you. Your neighbor, the colleague cannot stand you, but oh, how he loves you. This means that God's power makes you realize that God placed you in a love affair with the church, with your brother and sister, with the person next to you, that is far greater than the love that you can ever give out yourself because you have Christ's love. Because his love is wide, yours is narrow. His love is long, yours is short. His love is high, yours is low. His love is deep, yours is shallow. And we see this in the Passion Week of Jesus, when the disciples, their imperfect love failed him and they deserted him. He calls them back after his resurrection and sends them out with his love and say, go preach to those who are lost. And when the crowds poured hatred on him and they say, give us Barabbas. He says, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing. Now that's love. Let's notice in verse 18 again. Paul now tells them the scope of love. So the source of love, the sensibility of love, and the scope of love. Meaning, who grasped that God's powers effectually, the love of Christ within them? Look at verse 18 again. Together with all the Lord's people, or together with all the Lord's holy people, holy saints, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ. All the Lord's people in togetherness grasp that Christ is the source of love. All the Lord's people ought to grasp and understand and comprehend the love of Christ. No one is the exception to the love of Christ. If you claim to be a believer of Jesus Christ, and that God's power is therefore at work within you, you ought to understand not only to love because Christ loved, but you also realize that no one ought to be excluded from the love. In the church, in the body of Christ, we don't nitpick who we love. All the Lord's people, all the saints in togetherness, filled with the width and the depth and the length of the love of Christ to one another. Now, the reason why this is profound is because in chapter 4, Paul then moves into how the church, as the body of Christ, in unity, by a diversity of gifts, serves one another so the body can be built up in unity, love, and peace. This is why this is essential, that I don't only come to church serving the people I know and love. I come into church serving everybody. Because I love everybody. It's not about who's easier to love. It's not about preferences. It's not about similar interests. Oh no, he And I, or she and I, we love mountain biking. That's why on Sundays we only talk to each other. That's not love. You can go to Virgin Active and do that. It's not easy to find somebody with a similar interest. That's not love. Love is what Christ has done for us in a service capacity, one to another, everybody to one another. God's people, as we all know and experience, we come in a variety of personalities, temperaments, quirks, and weaknesses. We are called to love. These things are not necessarily sin, and often they are easier, but what if the believer sin against the other believer? We are called to love. It's called forgiveness. It demands a measure of patience, tolerance, prayer, care for one another. All God's people in togetherness. Some of us here might this morning be failing to love the believers, to love the church. Some of us might be struggling with unforgiveness, carrying bitterness, not knowing how to get over it. The power of God makes it possible for you and I to love. We got to go to the Lord and say, Lord, grant me that power. I want to love them again. Doesn't mean you have to be best friends. Three good friends in your life fill your whole life. Doesn't mean everybody has to hang out. It means we have to love as the church. And obviously, in action. So it leaves you and I with this question. Do you love Christ and His people? Do you grasp the love of Christ that it asks of you to love others? If you don't, perhaps it's because you do not have the power of God within you to produce that kind of love. If you do not have the power of God within you, that is Christ dwelling in you, it means you're probably not a believer. Believers love. That's why you struggle to love. That's why hatred is your primary emotion. And if that is the case, Christ invites you to lay down your sin, because He is dying on a cross for you, pouring out every form and measure of love that this world could ever see and comprehend, so that you can be a loving person. Do we know Christ this morning? Is Christ our power? Is Christ our love? Is Christ our joy? There's a place with Him for you. There's a place with Him for me and for all those who wants to see and feel and know and understand the righteousness that God will give you because He died for you. The greatest lover this world will ever lay eyes on. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we come to You in Jesus' name. Father, we realize and acknowledge that we do not love as we ought to. Father, we just think of Paul, who says that he became a servant of this gospel to preach to the Gentiles as a Jew, Lord. That God now by providence have made them part of the church, and that the church ought to be loving, O Father, and He prays for them. Lord, so I pray for us. I pray for my heart. I pray for Your people's hearts, that we will not fail and lack love. Lord, where we still struggle and sin, we pray that Your Holy Spirit will have grace upon us and fill us with love. Help us, O Lord, to pursue love, to grow in love. Thank You, Lord, that You are not done with us. We are still in Your care, under Your grace. You're still shaping us. You're still sanctifying us. You're still making us holy by your word and your truth. And so we know that there's great hope for us to become loving, loving your people, Lord, in every way and form that you ask of us. Lord, you are gracious, you are kind, and we know that we can come to your throne room of grace, repenting of our sin. And we don't have to stand ashamed, knowing that there's no condemnation in Christ Jesus. Oh Lord, when we do come, he's made it available and accessible for us to call on you to give us the love of Christ. Help us to not depend on our own strength and effort and personalities and quirks, Lord, but help us to depend on the love of Jesus. In your Son's name alone. And everybody says,
amen. Praise the Lord. You know, I've been preaching God's word for over 15 years, and last week after preaching, I received one of the best encouragements that I think one could get after you preach God's word. And someone came to me and they said, "Thank you for seeking Him. Thank you for seeking Him." And this morning, I also want to just thank Shane for seeking the Lord, and he served us well this morning, and we give God all the glory. Well, this time we're going to stand and sing our final hymn together. And so would you stand with me as we sing Abide With Me?
Abide with me, fast, fall asleep and hide. The darkness deep.
Praise the Lord. Please remain standing for the benediction. Hear the word of the Lord, Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. And all God's people say, Amen. The Lord bless you and have a wonderful Lord's Day.